Good afternoon, everybody. The time is 4:45, so we need to make a start to this session. I understand there'll probably be people joining us throughout. Thank you all for coming for the beginning. This session is all about optimizing recovery of performance. We have three speakers. I'll be chairing it. My name is Gareth Wallis from the University of Birmingham in the UK. We also have Professor Håkan Westerblad from the Karolinska Institute in Sweden, and Dr. Shona Halson from the Australian Catholic University. I think the interesting thing about this symposium is that we're all going to be looking at recovery from different aspects, because of recovery is obviously a complex process, so we need different perspectives. So hopefully there'll be a little bit of something for everybody in this this session. I don't want to occupy any more time, so I just want to invite our first presenter to the lectern. Professor Håkan Westerblad will be fulfilling the warm bath element in the title. So he's going to talk to us about the role of temperature in the recovery of muscle function.
Yeah, so thank you for inviting me to this meeting. So I'm going to talk about the temperature effects on recovery and the mechanism about it and related then to skeletal muscle function. And this is clearly a sort of a hot or maybe cold topic. That really depends on what you believe in. So here we have two different ways of looking at it. The Swedish soccer playing think that minus 80 is a good idea to recover, whereas the English believes that it's plus 80 or above that is the thing. And that is sort of interesting from a mechanistic viewpoint. It's very difficult to understand how cold could be good for recovery, and others think that heating is good for recovery. And I will try to explain that there is no simple answer to this. It really depends on what is limiting the recovery of muscle function in the first place. So if we start with the glycogen part of recovery, which is then the easier one to understand mechanistically, I would say. So there is the recovery of glycogen content in muscle fibers is rather slow. So after a competitive soccer match, as you can see here, it takes even 2 days, 48 hours after the game, the glycogen levels are not up to the original levels. And does that have an impact? Then we are, my specialty is more to look at the mechanism behind things. And this is the kind of preparation we use most of the time, our favorite preparation. So it's isolated single muscle fibers. This particular one is a muscle fiber from a mouse. And you stimulate it with electrical pulses, so it doesn't have any nervous system anymore, and then it contracts. And when it contracts, we can measure force, as you can see out to the right, and by injecting fluorescent indicators, we can measure other things, such as the calcium that activates the contractile machinery. So most of the time we use mouse fibers, but we can also use rat fibers. And recently we have also been able to do the same kind of experiment in the human muscle fibers. And basically the patterns or the mechanistic knowledge is more or less the same in the three of them. So we then come to glycogen. So we've done a study together with a group in Denmark, Nielsen and Nils Örteblad, and where we looked at the glycogen content in muscle fibers. And we could then use the same muscle fiber to do physiology, and then we froze it, and then electron microscopy to look at glycogen content. And up here, there it is, you can see the black dots there. That's the glycogen content in a rested fiber before fatigue. Then, of course, we can't study the same muscle fiber in the fatigued state. Then we need another one. But I think it's pretty obvious that here you can't see much of these glycogen, the dots, the glycogen content anymore. And the interest in glycogen, it's either sitting between the muscle fibers, called the myofibrils, intermyofibrillar, or inside the myofibrils, intramyofibrillar. And then it turns out that when you deplete the cells with of glycogen, with different types of fatiguing contractions, which means we do a short contraction, rest for a while, and then another short contraction, and do this in different manners. And it turns out that in the fatigued state, the calcium is down, and if you can look at the calcium versus the glycogen content, intramyofibrillar or inter or intra, and it's more or less the same picture there, that at high levels, so this is the control level or non-fatigue level, not much is happening to the activating calcium, but when you come to low levels, then there is a rapid decrease in the calcium during contractions, and it's a good correlation to both of them, that when you reach low levels, you have problems with releasing calcium inside the muscle fiber, and therefore you don't activate the contractile machinery appropriately. And then you also have the subsarcolemmic glycolin, which appears to be doing something else. So down here, the signal sits just beneath the surface. It doesn't really have anything to do with this. It must be doing something else. So when you reduce calcium, then you get something that we call prolonged low-frequency force depression. That means that the force is reduced when you stimulate the muscle at low stimulation frequencies, whereas it's more or less normal when you stimulate at high frequencies. Translate to the real world, so to speak, you feel that your legs are heavy if you're working with your legs. So you can actually do things, but it requires much more mental effort to do the running or what you're doing. And this PLFFD can then be due to two principally different things. It could be due to decreased calcium release from the sarcoplasmic reticulum during contractions, the red arrows. And what's illustrated with the red arrows is that when you're up here at high stimulation frequencies, if you reduce the calcium, not much is happening because of the shape of the force calcium curve. Whereas when you reduce calcium at the lower frequency, as soon as calcium drops a bit, force goes down a lot too. The alternative mechanism is that you have reduced myofibrillar calcium sensitivity, which also occurs in most types of fatigue. So then you need more calcium for a certain force all the time. Doesn't matter at high frequencies, but has a big impact at lower frequencies. So this idea with the what previously was called low frequency fatigue, but that term is used for almost everything these days, so it's impossible to know what people really mean when they talk about that. But PLFFD is not something peculiar, it's just a simple fact from the way muscles are activated. So then coming back to the mechanistic studies, and we try to look at what happens if you change the temperature during recovery, and then having glycogen in mind, and the fact that glycogen synthesis is an enzymatic process, and most likely is then affected by the temperature. So increasing the temperature, and most enzymatic reactions go faster. So as illustrated here, we have experiments where we first fatigue a muscle fiber, so force is going down like that, with repeated tetanic contractions, we have the tetanic calciums here. And then we allow the muscle to recover for 2 hours at 35 degrees, that is, or is it 36 degrees? That means elevating the temperature. 31 degrees, that is the in vivo temperature of this of the toe muscle we're using here. And then reducing the temperature to 26 and 16 degrees. And when you do this and look at tetanic calcium 2 hours later, you can see that at 36 degrees, there is full recovery, 100% is there, full recovery of tetanic calcium, 31 is good too, but at 26 and 16 degrees, it's much less of a recovery. And it's actually the same kind of recovery of titanic calcium as you see when you don't have any glucose in the solution, meaning that there can't be any glycogen restorage. So this is calcium that activates the muscle fiber. And when we then... And then we then look at force. It's the same kind of pattern, that the submaximal or low frequency force with at 36 degrees, it recovers, and it's back to normal after 2 hours. But with reducing temperature, recovery is worse. And down here at 26 and 16 degrees, recovery is only to 50% or so of what the force used to be. So clearly, if you reduce the temperature, recovery is worse in our isolated muscle fibers. And if we look at the glycogen, which is a bit more complicated to do these kind of experiments, but there it's the same story as one could predict, that when you deplete, in this case, the whole muscle with glycogen down to here, recovery at 26 degrees, it recovers less well than at 36 degrees. So the mechanism is clearly there. Now it's a matter of, can you then also show this in human experiments, in the real world, so to speak? So to do this, we did arm cycling, and it was done in collaboration with a group at Swedish Winter Sports Center Research Institute in Östersund. And the one testing the system here is Arthur Cheng, who is the main contributor to all the results, basically, I'm showing today. So he's here doing the arm cycling, and we decided on arm cycling because then we can have arm cuffs on the upper limb, and we can change the temperature of the muscles there in a rather effective way, and also measure the temperature that we get. And then we did this is the protocol used. So first we start with warm up for 2 times 4 minutes. Then comes the first test, and it's a 3 times 5 minute all-out cycling test. Thereafter, the glycogen depleting exercise, which is 4 times 15 minutes at 50% of VO2 max, which we found then in pilot experiments to reduce the glycogen rather severely. And thereafter, so the persons came in and did this 3 times. Once with heating, once with cooling, and one under control conditions, so nothing. And then after this 2 hour recovery, again the warm up, and then another testing session. And then we compared the first testing session to the second testing session. And the results show that in the first place, before doing an intervention and looking at the recovery, there was no difference. In the first before testing session, so to speak, they were identical. And then we had the recovery at different temperatures. The heating managed to increase the temperature by about 5 degrees, which was the maximum that the subjects could tolerate. Doing nothing, then the temperature stayed constant, the black ones. And cooling, it was cooling down to 15 degrees or so with the cooling arm cuff. And when looking at the performance then in the subsequent exercise, it was much better with heating than under control conditions, and clearly a lot worse when you did it with the cooling. So there we managed to show that if you have an exercise type where most likely glycogen depletion is a major factor, if you then heat up the muscles, speed up glycogen resynthesis, then you perform better after, in this case, a 2 hour recovery period. If we then come to more complicated ways to also have slow recovery, and in these experiments we are collaborating with a group at the Lithuanian Sports University in Kaunas, where they're really good at doing these experiments and also to electrically stimulate muscles to test muscle function directly without any impact from the nerve, so that we, in a better way, can translate it to what we do when we work at the isolated muscle cells or muscles. So if you do a sprint interval training, in this case it's wing gait cycling, so 30 seconds of absolute maximum power cycling. And you, in this case, did 1 30-second wing gait cycling, or 3 of them, and then 4 minute rest between them. And you can see during each cycling bout, it's quite severe acute fatigue occurring, so the power goes down from around 10 down to towards 6 or so. So towards the end of this, you can't really perform at the high power you could at the start. If we then look afterwards at recovery and electrical stimulation of the muscle, so no nerve input and so on, you can see that the force, the P20, that is stimulating at 20 hertz, stimulating at 100 hertz, and then the dividing the 20 with 100. So at 20 hertz, you have a rather severe force reduction after this rather limited exercise. The maximum exercise is then 3 times 30 seconds, or with 12 times 5 seconds, so rather short exercise periods, and still recovery after 60 minutes with the longer ones is less than 50% of the 20 hertz force is there. With the shorter one, you have a rapid, which we think is sort of acute metabolic recovery, but then you enter a more long-lasting phase. And you can continue this, and it takes about a day or so to recover from it. So it's a severe, long-lasting depression of force. There is some depression of force also at 100 hertz, but if you divide 20 by 100, it's much more severe at the low frequency. And that is then the prolonged low frequency force depression, which then could be due to either reduced calcium or reduced calcium sensitivity. And we have seen in many different ways of looking at intense exercise that the reactive oxygen nitrogen species, which I will abbreviate ROS, they are a part of this. And under control conditions, they seem to affect mostly the calcium release mechanism. So this is after exercise again, looking at submaximal tetanic contractions, and you can see that there is a reduction in calcium for 30 minutes. Then if you continue, not much is recovering during the next hours or so. So this is a prolonged phase of depression. And this decline in calcium reduces force a lot. And that the small decline in calcium can have such large effect is because the relation between calcium and force is very steep at the low frequencies. If you instead do the experiment at high frequency, there is not much happening to force. So you have, under normal conditions, you have a calcium problem. If you instead add antioxidants, so in this case we have the cocktail of antioxidants trying to take away all sort of known free radicals, the reactive oxygen nitrogen species we think of. Then, if you look at the force down here, it didn't get any better. If anything, it got worse. But now we don't have a calcium problem. Now we have a calcium sensitivity problem instead. And then one wonders, who cares? I mean, what does it matter if it's a calcium or calcium sensitivity problem? Well, I think the muscle cares, because the muscle calcium is a very good signaling ion that can turn on gene expression and so on, whereas calcium sensitivity is very difficult for the muscle to sense. So we have an hypothesis that we've been working along, and that is an important mechanism underlying adaptation to endurance training, we believe, is that you have an increase in free radicals, ROS, that causes changes in cellular calcium handling, mainly a leak from the internal stores, the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and an increased baseline calcium. That triggers mitochondrial biogenesis. That's been shown in many experiments that if you increase calcium, then you actually have more mitochondrial being made. And that leads to improved endurance. And this could then explain maybe the fact that several studies, this is one of the early ones, have shown that if you have effective antioxidant treatment, then endurance training becomes more or less useless. So you can take away the positive effects of endurance training, by effectively take away the free radical or the ROS triggering of adaptation. So this is very recent data from a training study we have done, where people have done 3 times a week HIIT training, so 4 to 6 HIIT sessions or Wingate cycling sessions, 3 times a week for 3 weeks. And they've done it under control conditions, or half of them got vitamin C and vitamin E in concentrations that are supposed to have a large impact on the oxidative defense. So a large increase in the antioxidants. And as you can see with the green symbols, we are here measuring the protein of various complexes in the mitochondria. And with antioxidant treatment, the green ones, the complex one, nothing happens after 3 weeks. Complex 2, 3, 4, 5, absolutely no response to the training then from a mitochondrial viewpoint. Whereas under control conditions, we can't see an increase in complex 1, 2. We can see an increase in complex 3, didn't really reach significance, but we had a significant increase in complex 4 and 5. And we're continuing to look at more parameters here, but it really looks like you take away the effect of the HIIT training by having effective antioxidants present. Another way to induce this prolonged low-frequency force depression is by repeated high-force eccentric contractions. And in this case, it's drop jumps. So you jump down and then you break with your quadriceps and then produce rather high-force eccentric contractions. And these are done at 30-second interval to minimize the metabolic component. So it's really just the eccentric component. And as you can see, with 10 drop jumps, you have a rather big decrease, a long-lasting decrease in the force at 20 hertz stimulation. You have some decrease also at 100 hertz, but it's more, if you divide them two, it's more low frequency than high frequency. After 100 drop jumps, it's really depressed. It's down to 20% or so, the 20 hertz force. The reduction also in the high force, but you divide them again, and it's more at the low frequency. So basically the symptom, if you exclude that you also have muscle soreness and so on after this, which you probably don't have after the others. But from a muscle viewpoint, you have the same thing. Reduced force at the low frequency mainly. Heavy legs if you translate it to the real world. When we look at mechanisms behind this, it's clearly a myofibrillar force generating problem. Exactly what's happening is very, very difficult to assess. But it's not obviously related to calcium or ROS. Calcium, of course, if you really overdo it, then the cells basically die, and then calcium goes high. And ROS, a few days later, when the leukocytes come in and so, there could be a ROS challenge. But the exercise as such doesn't seem to increase ROS levels. So to conclude, slow recovery of muscle function, prolonged low-frequency force depression, can be caused by several different mechanisms. And if muscle heating can speed up recovery when glycogen depletion is a dominating cause, whereas when there are other causes, then it's more complex. Regarding ROS, most likely ROS effects could be more severe at high temperature, but difficult to assess directly. And it could also be argued that it's the other way around. Myofibrillar problems, again, very difficult to say if it's going to be good or bad with heating or cooling. And then if you take the training aspect into it, maybe it's good with some challenge to muscles. If you prevent the first problem, so to speak, then the adaptation and the training response will get less. And these are the people that have been involved in it. It's the group at the Karolinska Institute, where Dr. Cheng has been a leading person. He's now moved to the York University. In the early glycogen measurements, we were collaborating with University of Southern Denmark, Nils Örtenblad and Joachim Nielsen. Mid-Sweden University, Östersund, they were involved in the arm cycling exercise, Hans Christer Holmberg and his team.
We are continually working with the Lithuanian Sports University, the group there, and also with University at Lausanne that also do some of our human experiments. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Håkon, for a fantastic presentation. We have a few minutes for questions, if anyone wants to ask. Maybe I can start while you're all thinking. So the heat seems to improve muscle glycogen synthesis after exercise. Your ROS data were quite interesting. Is there any effects of heat versus cool on ROS and subsequent adaptation that you're aware of?
Yeah, supposedly increasing temperature is supposed to also to increase ROS production, which in that case it could be beneficial to cool down the muscle. I think that may be the biggest problem actually during exercise, and then to cool or heat up muscles during exercise is a bit more complicated than during the rest periods. And also, not so sure, there have been reports that if you increase ROS, you can acutely really destroy muscle function. We have been able to increase the temperature of our single fibers up to well above 40 degrees without any problems whatsoever. So I think it's not that easy, actually, or obvious that ROS is causing any acute problems.
Greg Bogdanis from the University of Athens. Thank you very much for this very interesting talk. Could you please clarify something that I probably did not see? When you lower the temperature of the muscle and then you do a fatigue test, or you increase the temperature of the muscle and then you do a fatigue test, do you warm up the muscle before the test to a normal temperature, or you perform the test at this temperature that you brought it to?
Yes, so I wasn't clear there. So when we did looked at the temperature was 31 degrees during fatigue, always. The only time we changed the temperature was during the recovery period. And exactly the same thing in the human experiments. We changed the temperature during the rest period, and whereas the temperature was what it was during the actual exercise.
Thank you very much.
Jose Calvé from Las Palmas. Thank you very much for presentation. The limiting factor for recovery is supposed to be glucose supply. So to overcome this, we advise the athletes to have early supply of carbohydrates after exercise. But here you are saying that maybe it's more important to keep the muscle warm during the recovery. But what do you think is more important or more limiting, the temperature or the supply, or both things may be interacting?
Both. Yeah. Because if you heat it up without glucose, then nothing happens, of course.
There will be no recovery,
yeah.
Of course.
So in the experiments we did, we had sort of a normal glucose intake for the humans.
So the point where I'm going is that maybe if you have a high supply of glycogen, so temperature will be not that limiting.
Could be, but I would suggest that if you have enough glucose intake combined with increased temperature, that will be better than either on its own.
Okay, so we have the next experiment.
Okay, I think that's it for questions, so if we can just thank our speaker once more. Yeah, the middle one. And the top one. Okay, I have the pleasure of introducing myself to present here. So for those who didn't see the introduction, I'm Gareth Wallis from the University of Birmingham in the UK. So actually the last question is a nice segue into my talk, where I'm going to focus on nutrition and recovery. I've modified the title a little bit and included short term, because I'm talking really about the first few hours after exercise. And I appreciate recovery is a very broad topic, and particularly nutrition in recovery. So the focus is going to be mainly around carbohydrate metabolism and its role in recovery of exercise performance. Before I start, just want to acknowledge the financial support I've had over the last few years to do some of the work. And let's get started. So I've got two objectives today. Firstly, I want to spend some time setting up the context, which is really about trying to understand sugar metabolism during the post-exercise period. Some of this we've known about for many years, and then in recent years we've had some new developments in our understanding, which I'll share. And that's interesting because it has some potential functional implications. So the second part of the talk, I'll focus on really a discussion of the possible functional implications of this new knowledge. So we start with the metabolism. I forgot to mention chocolate milk, which of course was in the title of the session. I have nothing particularly invested in chocolate milk other than that I do like the taste of it. I think it's an interesting product because of its composition. And if you were doing a kind of very simple sports nutrition, you would say, oh, there's some carbohydrate, there's some protein, and there's fluid in there. So it has all of the things you want for recovery, refueling, rehydration, reconditioning, all the things that we kind of already know. But from my perspective, with an interesting carbohydrate metabolism, it's really the composition of the carbohydrate component that I find quite fascinating. Most chocolate milks that you find, of course, have some lactose in because of it being milk and being the intrinsic milk sugar. But most of them are also sweetened with sucrose, possibly for flavor reasons. But as a function of that, you actually end up with a very interesting blend because in the body, when those disaccharides are digested, they liberate these three monosaccharides, galactose, glucose, and fructose. And it's those differential metabolism of those sugars, those three monosaccharides, that I think raises some interesting questions, which I'll try and cover today. So the chocolate milk was really just a conduit to get to talking about galactose, glucose, and fructose. So we know quite a lot about muscle glycogen synthesis, and some of that has already been alluded to, the importance of a glucose source as a direct way to promote glycogen synthesis in muscle. And this paper from Blom back in 1987 is of interest because they showed after a period of fatiguing exercise in humans, providing a carbohydrate source at regular intervals in a six-hour recovery period, if you provide glucose, you can actually facilitate fairly rapid glycogen synthesis rates. Whereas if you provide an alternative source, such as fructose, the synthesis rates are markedly lower. So we can see here about half of the rate. And of course, we'd expect glucose to be high rates because of its direct potential for glycogen synthesis. And fructose, we know, has to be converted into something like glucose or potentially lactate before it can be used by the muscle. So that may explain these lower rates with the fructose. But certainly the message coming from that would be that if you want to enhance muscle glycogen synthesis, then glucose-based sources consumed early after exercise would be preferential as compared to fructose-based sources. One thing that we don't know much about at the moment is galactose. We'd kind of hypothesize because galactose behaves fairly similarly to fructose in terms of requiring processing in the liver before it can be converted to glucose, we might expect to see the same effect. But as far as I'm aware, we don't have any data on that. And actually, when I proposed this symposium 18 months ago, my expectation was we'd be able to have that data. Unfortunately, the things got a bit slow in the lab. So this is us last week trying to look at galactose metabolism. So hopefully next year I can share that information for you. So we don't know a lot about galactose-mediated glycogen resynthesis in muscle. The other interesting finding from the study from Blom back in 87 is that if you double the dose of carbohydrate, in this instance glucose, the glycogen synthesis rates don't increase. So that means that something is limiting glycogen synthesis here in muscle. Interestingly, if you directly infuse glucose and insulin into the circulation, you can achieve much higher rates of glycogen synthesis in muscle than seen in this image. So that suggests that there could be a gastrointestinal or a splanchnic limitation to muscle glycogen synthesis. Many of you will be familiar with slides like this that my former PhD supervisor, Professor Asker Jukendrup, has created, and it really demonstrates that if you combine different types of sugars, in this instance glucose and fructose, you can achieve higher rates of intestinal absorption and increase the delivery of carbohydrate, at least during exercise, and that allows for an increased oxidation of ingested carbohydrate. So these glucose-fructose mixtures are a very effective way to increase carbohydrate delivery, at least during exercise. And some years ago, we wanted to ask the question, well, if we can do this during exercise, what about after exercise? Could this be a way to facilitate increased muscle glycogen synthesis? So we had a study where we had fairly well-trained men perform exhaustive exercise, cycling exercise, and then recover for 4 hours. And there was two conditions. They were provided with a fairly large amount of glucose or a mix of glucose and fructose, so a third of the dose was fructose. And we measured muscle glycogen synthesis rates over the four-hour recovery period, the hypothesis being the fructose glucose condition may accelerate delivery and accelerate muscle glycogen synthesis. So this is what we saw. The synthesis rates were essentially the same. We saw no real differences between the two conditions. So of course, you know, you're always a bit disappointed when your hypothesis doesn't come out, but that's more often than not in my experience. But I think what was interesting here is that actually taking 30 grams per hour of glucose away didn't impede the rate of muscle glycogen synthesis. So it seemed like we were giving enough glucose anyway to achieve high rates, and you certainly didn't need any more. When we delved into, well, what might be going on here, we of course probably forgot the critical role of the liver in the regulation of whole body carbohydrate metabolism. And we know from infusion studies done in the 70s that if you infuse fructose, it's preferentially metabolized in the liver, whereas if you infuse glucose, it's preferentially metabolized in the periphery. So one idea articulated in the discussion of this article is that maybe the fructose is going to the liver. Some years later, 2011, this really interesting paper was published where they largely replicated the design of the study we had done, but instead of focusing on the muscle, they actually looked at the liver, and they used a 13C MRS to non-invasively assess liver glycogen resynthesis during recovery. And so they, again, they had a glucose-only condition or a glucose-fructose condition. And what they're able to show here, which sort of confirmed what we thought might have happened, is an almost doubling of the rate of liver glycogen synthesis over a six-hour recovery period when fructose was included in the mix as compared to when it was a glucose-only based carbohydrate source. So that seems, if you put that together with the glycogen data in muscle that we had generated, it would appear that these combinations may actually lead to a higher overall carbohydrate storage in recovery. I think one interesting finding that's often overlooked in this paper is actually they had a galactose glucose condition as well, and they see exactly the same result as the fructose condition. So that's an almost doubling of liver glycogen synthesis, which again suggests the galactose may behave in a similar way to the fructose in being preferentially stored in liver. What we don't know at the moment is what happens with these galactose glucose mixes in terms of muscle. So actually, is there any inferiority in muscle glycogen synthesis, or is it the same? And that's one of the other arms in the study we have ongoing. So just to summarize that first part, the oral glucose seems to be superior to fructose for muscle glycogen synthesis in the short-term period after exercise. In contrast, oral fructose is superior to glucose for liver glycogen synthesis after exercise. So if you put those together, you have an enhanced short-term total post-exercise glycogen storage. I articulated that kind of concept in a review in 2013, which is just piecing everything together. There was a really nice paper published in 2016 from Kaas Fuchs in Maastricht, where they actually studied all of this in one study. So it was really nice to show that, and they used sucrose as the model there to deliver fructose, but they were able to show both in liver and muscle that the sucrose enhanced liver glycogen synthesis versus glucose and did not impair the glucose, the glycogen synthesis in muscle. So it was a nice way of showing it all within one study. So the second part of the talk is basically trying to ask the question, well, the metabolic recovery looks really interesting. What does this actually mean for recovery of function? So I had a really good master's student started with me in 2017, Ed Maunder, who drove this study, where we asked a very, very simple question. Does fructose-glucose co-ingestion during short-term recovery enhance the subsequent exercise capacity? He designed this study where we had moderately trained endurance athletes who had a strong running background, and they first performed a treadmill run to volitional exhaustion at 70% of VO2 max. And the idea here was to obviously reduce muscle glycogen stores. They had a four-hour recovery period, and during that period they either consumed glucose-based carbohydrate sources, in this instance it was a glucose maltodextrin mix, or they had a combination of fructose and maltodextrin to kind of get the dual sugar delivery. After a four-hour recovery period, they then repeated the treadmill exercise test to exhaustion. This is a pretty tough protocol, actually. The main outcome was endurance capacity, as time to exhaustion, but we also measured substrate oxidation with indirect calorimetry. And the carbohydrates we used had a high natural abundance of C13, so we were able to actually quantify the oxidation of the ingested carbohydrate during the subsequent bout. So that could give us an idea really of what's actually happening to the ingested sugars. We had some blood markers and some perceptual scales as well. So simple question, simple answer. Yes, the time to exhaustion was quite markedly improved with the fructose maltodextrin condition, just over 30% improvement in time to exhaustion. So we were quite impressed with that, quite surprised by the magnitude of that, but it was obviously quite an interesting result because it suggested that, you know, there is some kind of relationship between the metabolic recovery and the subsequent endurance recovery. And when we actually looked at some of our other measurements we made, we didn't really see anything going on differentially between conditions in terms of blood markers or gastrointestinal distress or RPE, but the carbohydrate oxidation data was very interesting. The top graph here shows total carbohydrate oxidation, and the open circles are the kind of glucose-only trial. And what you can see in both conditions, in the first part of that subsequent bout, the carbohydrate oxidation is fairly similar. And then in the maltodextrin glucose trial, the open circles, it's markedly lower at the point of fatigue, which, you know, is not uncommon. You might expect a deterioration in carbohydrate oxidation coinciding with the capacity to maintain a fixed intensity when the exercise is reasonably intense. I guess what was interesting is with the maltodextrin fructose condition, of course, the fatigue length was extended, but if we modeled the predicted effect of on total carbohydrate oxidation. So we tried to estimate what the oxidation rate would be at the point of fatigue during the glucose-only trial, and it was significantly higher. So it suggested that, certainly that intervention improved the ability to maintain carbohydrate oxidation, and that may have contributed to the enhancement in endurance. In the bottom part of the slide, that actually shows the oxidation of the ingested carbohydrate using the 13C methodology, and that kind of confirms actually that yes, there was certainly more carbohydrate available to the exercisers during that subsequent bout. So we published this in May last year, and at the same time I presented it at ACSM in a conference, and people were tweeting about it as they do. And then of course somebody said, well, what about performance? Endurance capacity doesn't mean anything, it's all about performance. And I'm not really one that gets into these debates, but we said, well, let's ask the performance question. Let's look at a time trial model. And Tim Podlegar, who is here this week and will be presenting tomorrow, has just finished this study. So we had some of the data in, 2 weeks ago. So I'm just going to share some of these preliminary results with you in the last few minutes. And this is where it becomes more of a discussion about the effects rather than a conclusive outcome. So does it improve performance? We took, we modified some aspects of the protocol from the Maunder project. So we did it in cyclists. We had a high intensity intermittent cycle to exhaustion as the fatiguing exercise bout. We still had the 4-hour recovery with the same blends. But then in the subsequent exercise bout, we had a 1-hour steady state exercise bout. Because we were quite interested in getting a bit more detail on the substrate utilization. And in that first study, some people just weren't going long enough for us to actually, you know, really get some meaningful information. So we said, let's try and have a 1 hour. And to do that, we lowered the intensity a little bit. So it's 50% watt max, which came out just over 60% VO2 max. And then we had a time trial, which was estimated to last for about 40 minutes, and that to complete a set workload as fast as possible. And that was our primary outcome, and of course we had the same sort of supplementary measures as well as in the Maunder study. So to get to the, I guess, the take home of this project, the answer was no. We didn't see any improvements in time trial performance with the fructose maltodextrin condition versus the glucose maltodextrin, so that glucose-only condition. So those means and the standard deviations, you know, were fairly similar to between trials. So that kind of led to, in the last couple of weeks, quite a lot of head scratching, which is the result of me now not having any hair, as you can see. No, but seriously, we haven't got all of the data back, but we've got some of the oxidation data, which I'm going to share with you today, because I think it does provide some insights into what might be going on in this particular situation. So this graph here actually shows the ingested carbohydrate oxidation. So the 13C label, ingested during recovery, and then the evolution during the next bout of exercise. And the orange line is the fructose maltodextrin trial, and you can clearly see in the first sort of 45 minutes that's significantly higher than the glucose maltodextrin trial, which suggests higher oxidation rates, higher availability of that ingested carbohydrate. But that starts to subside by the end of the exercise bout. So they're not actually different at that 60-minute time point, which is the point right before the start of the time trial. This is a reminder to say, actually, to signal you to go to watch a poster tomorrow, because for those of you who are familiar with this area, the quantification of exogenous carbohydrate oxidation in the first hour of exercise is usually avoided because of uncertainties in the retention of the 13 CO2 label in the bicarbonate pool. We knew that we weren't going for over 60 minutes, so we've done some methodological work to try and ensure that this data is validated. And Tim Podlager's got a poster on this tomorrow, so I'd encourage people to go and have a look about that. Look at that. But back to the story, the bottom graph shows the total carbohydrate oxidation. So the top is ingested, the bottom is total. And we don't see any difference between the two conditions. So we don't fully understand what's going on here yet, but it could well be that there was greater storage in recovery with the fructose, but that led to greater utilization during the next exercise bout, such that at the point of starting the time trial, they might have actually been in a very similar metabolic state, and subsequently the performance was very similar. So we'll do some blood work on this when we get back, and we'll try and understand a bit more about the story. But I think it goes to show that it might not be as simple as we thought, and there may be a bit more work needed before we can really tease out exactly when and if these types of mixtures might be advantageous. So it's my concluding slide, which is really about the second part of the talk. So I think oral glucose fructose during recovery does increase subsequent utilization during exercise. So I think there is potential for ergogenic advantage with these types of mixtures, but it's probable that the precise specification, so the dose, the type, and the particular exercise context might need some further understanding before we can fully conclude on their role in recovery. So with that, I just want to say thank you for everybody for coming, and thank you for your attention. And I'm going to introduce questions for myself. So if anybody has any questions, please do come to the microphone.
Gareth, I have a question. On your left-hand side. Gasfuchs, Maastricht University. Thank you for the interesting talk, Gareth. I was wondering, what do you think of mixing all three monosaccharides together, so having glucose, fructose, as well as galactose, and then look at post-exercise recovery? Do you think there's any further benefit of accelerating glycogen repletion above, for example, just glucose and fructose?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question, and I think hypothetically that could be the kind of optimal blend, providing that the liver can take galactose and fructose and convert to glycogen at the same time, and there's no interference there. So I don't think it's been done, but it would be potentially the kind of optimal condition. So that would be interesting to do. Yeah. I guess I can't ask myself a question, can I? Okay. Well, actually, we're on good timing then. So we'll move on to the next speaker. If you can come and help. Okay, it gives me great pleasure to invite Dr. Shona Halson to the stage. Shona is from the Australian Catholic University, but has spent many years at the Australian Institute of Sport as the head of recovery. So he's a real wealth of knowledge on the application of recovery strategies in elite sport. Today, she's going to be presenting on probably one of her favorite topics, which is around sleep and sports performance.
Thank you. Thanks, Gareth, and thanks for doing all the hard work in putting this this session together, and thanks everyone for hanging around for the last presentation. So what I wanted to do with this particular session was to go through some of the more topical things around sleep and sports performance. So I think there's a few sort of key questions that, that people ask, and hopefully by the end of the presentation I will have answered them in some way. So the first question ultimately is sleep important for athletes? And I think we all think it is, and anecdotally we hear that it is, but what is the evidence to support it? How much sleep do athletes actually get? It's probably only been in the last few years that we've started to monitor and actually understand how they're sleeping. If they're not sleeping that well, what are some of the things that might be disturbing their sleep? What is the best way to measure sleep? Anyone who knows anything about the area knows it's the wild, wild west. Every company out there is creating a sleep device. Understandably, it's, you know, everyone sleeps. So not just for athletes, but for the general population, sleep is of interest at the moment. And then if our athletes aren't sleeping that well, what can we do to actually fix it? So the first question is sleep actually important for athletes? And we don't have a huge amount of data in this area. What we have is a lot of information from the general population. And so we have, you know, a range of information around how it's important for the brain, how it's important for mood, the immune system, for metabolism, and for the muscle. So the research in the area of sleep and health is rapidly increasing. So we're understanding a lot more about the importance of sleep in these major areas. So what we tend to do with athletes is think that, okay, well, if this is important for the general population, well, perhaps it's even more important for athletes who may have a greater physical requirement for recovery in the form of sleep. But what's the actual evidence that we have out there? So the studies that demonstrate a reduction in performance, so there have been some, there is some research out there that shows that sleep deprivation can result in decreased performance, but typically these studies use 30 hours or more of sleep deprivation, which I have seen in athletes on the odd occasion, but typically not before an important event. They're often laboratory-based studies, typically conducted in non-elite athletes, and we know that young, fit, healthy athletes are often quite resilient. And typically when we look at these studies, there's no changes in any of the physiological measures that are made. Typically what we see is there's an increased perception of effort, which I think a lot of people experience when they have a certain level of sleep deprivation. So on the other hand, research investigating the effects of sleep extension is limited, but there has been some positive effects shown. So we assume that if sleep deprivation is bad for performance, sleep extension should be good for performance, and there's very, very little data out there. As I said, some of the data, though, does suggest that it does enhance performance. A couple of other studies that kind of hint that this might be important is that in a survey of a large number of elite Brazilian athletes, they found that sleep was an independent predictor of poor competition performance. This was just subjective, though. There was no objective measures. And then some work that Laura Juliff did with elite Australian netball athletes using objective sleep monitoring, using activity monitors, found that longer sleep durations were positively associated with finishing place in a tournament. So as you can see, there's not a huge amount of strong data there that's really relevant to the elite population, but based on that, we do believe that sleep is important for the elite athlete, but it's certainly an area where we could be doing more research. When you look at some of these performance changes, we tend to see a lot of changes really occurring around the cognitive aspect of performance. So this is some work from Matt Driller and his group across the ditch in New Zealand, and they did a nice review and they looked at some of these aspects of actual performance in sport. So whereas a lot of other researchers looked at, you know, time trial performance in the lab, so they've actually looked at some aspects of real performance and in particular cognitive function, because it is one of the things that tends to deteriorate first. It is one of the things that changes with sleep deprivation initially. And everything that, you know, all of these studies that they report did show that there was an effect of sleep deprivation around cognitive performance in athletes. So how do athletes sleep? So most people would think we see athletes getting around with a certain level of fatigue. Most athletes are tired, and if they're not, they might not be training hard enough. But does tiredness actually equal sleepiness? And does tiredness actually result in having better sleep? And what we see typically is that that's not the case. So this is some data that we've collected. I don't know if Mick's in the audience, but we do a lot of work with Central Queensland University, the Appleton Institute, and they've published a reasonable amount of work in this area. So, and what we've seen is that total sleep time in athletes somewhere around 6.5 to 7 hours, which is typically less than we would like, and typically less than the general population. Jonathan Leader and his group from the UK have also shown some similar data where athletes were sleeping poorer than age-matched controls. So why is that? If we think that athletes need more sleep and they probably have a higher physiological requirement for it, why aren't our athletes sleeping? And one of the things that, that may cause that is early training times. In Australia in particular, we have some sports that get up very early to train. Swimming, rowing, triathlon, there's a range of reasons for that, some good, some not so good. But what we see is that the earlier the training start time, then the less sleep that the athletes are getting, which seems like a no-brainer. But what happens is athletes either can't go to bed early enough to get enough sleep because they're waking up so early, or they just don't go to bed early enough to get enough sleep. So sometimes they're training late, sometimes they obviously have to eat post-training the night before, so sometimes there's just not the time to be able to get the amount of sleep that they need. The other thing that can disturb sleep is poor routines. So this is some work we collected in data on our swimmers in the lead up to Beijing, and what we see is that we give them a day off and they sleep in. So what happened, in this particular graph, you can see that the standard deviation in terms of wake-up times on a Sunday, when they've had the Sunday off, is up around 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, this is a group that typically, and in this study, found that they're getting up at about 12 minutes to 6. Training starts at 6, they're waking up at 12 minutes to 6. So what happens is we give them a day off and they alter their sleep cycle. So of course we want them to sleep in, and we want them to get more sleep, but it seems that their routine is particularly poor. So we know that shift workers are quite bad sleepers. Now, not that this is shift work, but when you have these strange patterns with people sleeping in on weekends, then that can really interfere with their sleep. Now, this obviously, you can imagine an NBA team that might be playing three times a week, travelling across the US, how difficult it would be for them to get good sleep, even if they were trying to get good sleep and doing all the right things. The other thing that we know that disturbs sleep is late night games. Now, we've heard that for a long time, and this is probably us doing the research to catch up on what we already know with athletes. So this was some work from Benita Layla, and what she did was she looked at the time of Australian rules football game in the same team. So there was either afternoon games, twilight games, or night games, and looked at their sleep post those games. And what she found was it didn't matter what time the game was, there was definitely later bedtimes, but statistically the only one that was different from normal was the night games. So these games start around 7:45 and they can go till pretty late. So you can appreciate that sleeping after, you know, playing in front of 80,000 people in front of a packed stadium would be challenging. So we know that the schedule of the timing of competitions and in games like team sport with professional athletes can have some challenges. But there's lots of other things as well. So that's sort of the science that we have, but there's definitely other things that we think has an influence on their inability to sleep. So things like just not prioritising sleep, everything else becomes more important. Social media, we know that can be particularly problematic for athletes. Stress and anxiety, whether that's around thoughts around the competition or thoughts around getting selected for teams, that can be an issue as well. We know that caffeine can interfere with sleep. Alcohol, unfortunately, not good for sleep. It might help you fall asleep, but it certainly doesn't help you stay asleep. And overall, it is negative for our sleep. The time of competition, the time of training, intensified training. So we've done a couple of studies in this area, and Sophie Killer's also done a study in this area where we find that intensified training, where the athletes might be doing a higher volume and high intensity, instead of them sleeping better because they have an increased recovery requirement, they tend to sleep poorer. So we see them and they look exhausted and they look tired and they're irritable and they're grumpy, but they're not sleeping that well. So consideration to how they're sleeping during intensified training is important. If they're sore, if they're injured, their chronotype may affect their ability to sleep. Their age, adolescence is an interesting time, usually quite negative in terms of sleep. For people that may have children, of course, jet lag and travel can be problematic as well. But in the real world, we probably see these three things as being most problematic. Fortnite, I think for the age of the athletes that we work with at the moment, athletes are all competitive, so get them on a computer game, and it can certainly steal some sleep time. So how do we actually measure sleep? As I said, there's lots of different ways to measure sleep, and everyone is out there trying to make some money in terms of selling people a device. So we have things like up here in the top corner. So this is polysomnography, so this is the gold standard. If anything tells you, any device is telling you that it can measure what stage of sleep that you're in, and you don't have something attached to the scalp to measure brain activity, then it's lying to you, or it's using some kind of indirect way of trying to assess stages of sleep. We tend to use these type of devices, activity monitors. This is the Philips range that we tend to use. Fatigue Science is another, Fitbit, devices like Bedit, and some of the other devices where we call them nearables, so they're not wearables, they're put near the person to assess their sleep. And of course, things like questionnaires, and there's plenty of apps as well that are out there. So to try and get through some of the muddy waters, I planned on putting together a really simple table to look at the positives and negatives of the devices. Unfortunately, it didn't end up so simple, and I don't expect you to read this. I'll just talk over the kind of key aspects of this. So polysomnography, yes, gold standard, measures sleep stages or sleep architecture. It is one of those things that we tend to use for research or if we suspect an athlete has a medical sleep disorder. It is time and labour intensive, and it's not something you use for longitudinal monitoring. If anyone's ever been wired up, you know that it's not that easy to sleep, and so it really is used for sort of one-off assessments. The activity monitors that we use, which we know are validated, they've been compared to polysomnography, we know what the algorithms are to detect sleep and wake, we're very comfortable with how they work. They're the things that we tend to use most. They have an accelerometer in them which detects movement, and we use the software to analyse the sleep. They still require some expertise. From someone to be able to interpret that data and turn it into a workable format. And they're not cheap and they're not easily to get commercially. The other thing that's out there is commercial sleep monitoring devices, so things like the Fitbit and the Whoop. One thing we know about a lot of these devices is they're reasonably good at picking up sleep, but they're not great at picking up wake. So if you have a lot of wake in your sleep, they tend to overestimate the amount of sleep that you're getting, which means the poorer sleeper you are, the more overestimation of your sleep that you're going to have. So really some of the negative aspects around this is, one, it's not really giving you that good of data. Two, we find that some people can get quite obsessed with the numbers, and having access to your sleep numbers all the time for some people is not always a good idea. But one of the positives around it is that it may start to get people to think about their sleep, and it may start to connect them with someone who can actually help them with their sleep and who knows something about sleep. So it might stimulate a conversation with an expert. Then there's these commercial devices that have pretty much no validation, or if they either haven't been assessed in terms of their validity, so most of these devices aren't considered medical devices, so you don't need to go and do any sort of assessment before you start selling them, and some of these can have some really interesting numbers that they provide in terms of their accuracy. So these are typically the nearable devices, where you might have an app next to the bed. Some of them have been looked at and found that they just don't even measure sleep in any capacity. Of course, then there's sleep diaries and questionnaires, and there's certainly ones of these that are more valid and reliable. Typically, what we see is most of these questionnaires are designed for insomnia. Most of our athletes don't have insomnia. They're just doing strange behavioural things. So that now there are a couple of more sleep-specific questionnaires for athletes that can help get to some of these questions. So how do we improve sleep? And, you know, it's pretty basic stuff. I think I often say it's nothing that your mother didn't tell you when you were a kid. I think most people know what to do to get good sleep. I think most athletes now know what they should be doing, but what we find is that they tend to not actually do it. So, you know, standard things around, you know, your room environment, make it cool, dark and quiet, be careful with your caffeine. You know, there's lots of things that I'm sure everyone in this room is very familiar with. So one of the things that I was interested in was, this was done by one of my PhD students who was working with a professional rugby league team in Australia and did some sleep monitoring for 2 weeks and some education and found that, fantastic, their sleep improved. But as soon as we left them alone and came back and assessed them a month later, they were straight back to where they were before. So we know that education and monitoring is important and it can help with athlete sleep, but it's certainly not the only solution. And so now we are looking more towards what are some of the behaviour change strategies and can we use some of the science around behaviour change to help help get our athletes to make some better decisions, because, I mean, let's face it, at sleep, it shouldn't be that hard to do for most people. It's not unpleasant, it's not uncomfortable, but if we can't get athletes to change what they're doing around sleep, then what hope have we got for some of the other things that we're asking them to change? So in terms of, to essentially just to finish off here, what I would look at in terms of how I might go about a process when I'm working with an athlete to try and assess their sleep and what it might look like. So this is all the steps that you could follow. You might not follow all of them, but this is a bit of a process that you could follow. So first of all, just talking to the athlete, so getting some ideas of their sleep and wake times, discuss their behaviours, thinking about any stress or anxiety that they might have. The interesting thing about sleep is we've all been doing it since day one. So a lot of people have their own unique strategies that they've done forever that they think is particularly normal. And so they just think that what they're doing is good behaviourally. You can start to do some screening with some questionnaires and just get a bit of an understanding of where they're at. They might hint to you where you might need to look in terms of correcting their sleep. We would then go ahead, if we needed to, with some activity monitoring, so actually looking at using a validated device, and usually we like to include 1 to 2 weeks, because weekends are usually where the wheels tend to fall off, so we like to make sure that we get weekends in there as well. If you suspected at any point during the process that the athlete might have a medical sleep disorder, and in athletes maybe sleep apnea would be the one that we would see most commonly, but it's not something that we do see all the time, but you can send them off to have a study either at home or in a laboratory-based setting. In terms of feedback and education, I think this is really critical, and one of the things that we see now is a lot of people are doing sleep monitoring but are not so good at the feedback and understanding what things need to be changed and how to change them. I think you need to be really careful with how you talk to an athlete who might be having poor sleep. I certainly don't tell them they're the worst sleeper I've ever seen, even if they are. So I think there's ways of giving that information and giving the education to not cause additional stress and anxiety. Then we can look at behaviour change strategies, and I think that it's important to look at the environment as well, because if you think back to that list of some of the reasons why athletes don't sleep well, there's some of the things that they choose to do behaviourally, and there's some of the things that we impose. Training times, schedules, meeting times, flight times. So some of the things are out of their control and more in our control. So looking at what things can we change to create a better environment for the athlete. And unfortunately, you probably have to do this more than once because we see that sometimes athletes are good for a period of time and then they fall back, and then we need to keep up with the education and the little hints and the subtle education, the signage, the little trapped ways that we can try and get the athletes to have more awareness around their sleep. So just to finish off, I'll try to answer those five questions that we started out with. So firstly, is sleep important for athletes? Yes, however, we probably need more research on one, sleep extension. So does increasing sleep actually help performance? We probably need to do more moderate sleep deprivation studies rather than the full 30 hours of sleep deprivation, and we definitely need more work in an elite population. But I would say, on the basis of the evidence that we would have right now, that sleep is important for athletes from a performance perspective. One thing we do know is that generally speaking, not every athlete, but generally speaking, athletes have a poorer quality and quantity than the general population. What things disturb sleep in athletes? We have scientific evidence around the timing of competition, training, caffeine, stress, and thoughts around competition. We don't have much data on social media use, but I think that's one of the no-brainers. Whenever we do sleep monitoring studies, we ask athletes to fill out diaries and ask them how long they use their phone or they're playing computer games before bed, and it's not surprising to see 3 to 4 hours fairly consistently of electronic device use before bed. What's the best way to measure sleep in athletes? Obviously, polysomnography for a sleep-related medical disorder, preferably using a validated activity monitor, using a validated questionnaire. The majority of commercial technology, however, is either not validated and or over, if it has been examined, it tends to overestimate the amount of sleep that athletes are getting. So how do we improve sleep in athletes? We still have to do some form of education with them, even though it's not the only solution. I think some education is important. Starting to think now about how we can introduce some of these behaviour change strategies and thinking about the environment that they're in and how we can potentially manipulate the environment to help them make better choices around their sleep. I mean, one of the simple things to look at is when we house athletes together. We see that all the time, they all go to bed at the same time. And so looking at how we house them, we also need to look at the timing of flights. We often wake people up really early in the morning to get on a flight rather than sending them the night before. So I think there's lots of things that we can do in our environment to help them get better sleep. And of course, psychology is a major important part of sleep. There's a very close relationship between stress and anxiety and an inability to sleep. So looking at some of the psychological strategies, I think is really important, especially around competition, because people can be good sleepers in the real world and then get to competition and Olympic Village with the whole world there, the whole world's media, and then they struggle to sleep. So thank you, and thanks to my collaborators, in particular Central Queensland University and Swimming Australia, who we've done a lot of the research on the swimmers with.
Thank you very much, Shona. Fantastic presentation. We have time for questions.
Hi, I'm Claudia Juzviak from the Federal University in São Paulo, Brazil. Thanks for the outstanding presentation. I would like to know, in addition to alcohol and caffeine that you mentioned, if you could recommend, suggest any other dietary strategies to help sleep, especially before competitions.
That's a very good question, and I know it's a good question because we've finished one study and we're about to do another study looking at that exact thing, looking at some dietary interventions that might help help athletes sleep. I think until we have some really good solid evidence, you know, the studies that have been done have used a range of different ingredients with a range of different timings, and it's really hard to give anything conclusive because the research is really variable. But in the general population, there's plenty of research around good old milk in terms of having a lot of the ingredients that you would need to potentially enhance sleep. But we know there's some herbal things like valerian that has a bit of evidence, tryptophan has a little bit of evidence, but in terms of being able to give really good concrete advice on timings and amounts, we're just not there yet. I think there's a lot of potential, but we're not there yet.
Thank you very much.
So you said it was a no-brainer, so to speak, that if you have to train very early in the morning, you sleep less. But if you're a professional athlete, don't you have time to take a nap later during the day to compensate? And
some do. I think it does depend on the sport. A lot of them would have some opportunity, and I think what they can get in a habit of doing is napping during the day and then saying, oh, well, it doesn't matter if I don't sleep that well at night because I have the opportunity to nap. It really does depend on the sport and the individual, if they are at university or school, or, I mean, you talk to younger athletes at school and who are at school and you ask them, do they have time to sleep during the day? They say no. I say, do you sleep during the day? And they say yes, during class, all of them. So a lot of them will find a way of sleeping during the day. But I mean, if you look at an NFL team, for example, I mean, they're at the club at 6 o'clock in the morning or 7 o'clock in the morning, and they can be there all day watching video. So there's no chance of a nap. But naps, I think, are good as a top up for those who don't get the sleep that they need at night.
Hi, Shona. Thanks for the presentation. I'm Anthony from Hong Kong. Just to follow up on the nap question, so the utilization of naps, I think there's been some preliminary research from Japan that has used caffeinated naps, so you have some coffee before a nap, and mm-hmm. it's been shown to improve cognitive tasks thereafter. Yep. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think it's an interesting concept, and there might be something to it. I think, so the idea being that you have some caffeine, then have a nap, and by the time the caffeine hits into the system effectively, you've woken up and you've got the double benefits of the caffeine and the nap. I think there's a couple of potential concerns with it. Is that one, you know, everyone metabolizes caffeine, well, people can metabolize caffeine at very different rates, so that can potentially be problematic. The other thing is some people might need more than a 20-minute nap or a 40-minute nap even. If you're working with really sleep-deprived individuals, which we often do with athletes, they may be needing a reasonably long nap. But the caffeine sort of will kick in when you're actually still wanting them to sleep. But I think in theory, and some of the evidence around in the transport industry and in truck drivers and alertness, you know, there's becoming some good evidence there. But I think the practicalities can be challenging. And in my experience, a lot of athletes have a lot of caffeine during the day. So it's not just the last dose of caffeine you've had, but it's the accumulation and the build-up. So in theory, yes. In practice, we probably need to get it right.
Thank you. Just one more quick question. What's your thoughts on sleep banking? So if there is issues with sleep or there is some sort of sleep deprivation, particularly before a tournament, allowing athletes to moderate their sleep and maybe getting a little bit extra just to balance it out?
Yeah, I think, again, we're not 100% sure of the answer to that, but I prefer to have an athlete sleep more than sleep less. So to use that to be able to say it's a good opportunity to get more sleep, that they should take it. I think one of the things that we see is that if you've had a good bank of sleep for a decent period of time and you have one bad night or two bad nights, it's not the end of the world. But if you've had a block of average sleep or not so good sleep and then you have a couple of bad nights, you're probably more likely to be negatively affected by those bad nights. I think one of the things we also have to be careful about is routine, is we don't want to have these big changes in routine all the time. But overall, I would prefer, you know, the idea of sleep banking to me just means for athletes is probably getting just the amount of sleep that they actually should be getting anyway. But I think, yeah, there's benefits to getting more sleep, and any way that we can encourage that, it's worth doing.
Thank you.
Hi, nice presentation. Julio Costa from the University of Porto. I think that most of the research dealing with health measurements, such as sleep, most of the data are presented as average, and also most of the data compare the results as a guideline, according, for example, to the National Sleep Foundations, between 7 and 8 hours. And my question is, it's like a provocative question. We can compare that normal results, like general populations, like for the athletes. Can we say that athletes are like to the normal population?
If I think I've got your question,
yeah, sorry,
and if I think I understand it correctly, I think you're exactly right. There are, within the general population, there are people who sleep a small amount and a long amount, and yes, we say 8 hours is reasonable for what people should be sleeping. We definitely see extremes among our athletes as well. There's one team that I've just worked with, female team, who are getting a lot of good sleep. And they certainly, if you were to look on some of the figures, they would be way outliers because they're exceptionally good. And then there's other teams I work with have really, really short durations of sleep. So you're right, it's highly individual. And then there are, within that, there are people who can probably tolerate shorter sleep than others. Then we know there's now quite a strong genetic component. So it's very difficult for us to tell an athlete how much they need. And so it's often around asking them questions around how they feel when they wake up and whether they get through the day or not. So you're right, comparing to averages, if that's what you're trying to get at, I think is not always correct. And we have some that are definitely at the extremes, not only within individuals, but on certain nights in a week anyway.
Thanks for a great talk. Jamie Prout from Otago, New Zealand. I'm just wondering, some of these technologies, like the consumer available ones, like the watches and the apps and stuff like that, they roughly track people's deep sleep and light sleep and things like that. And sometimes they give people an option to, say, wake up perhaps 20 minutes earlier, but it'll wake them up in light sleep. And I think the idea is people wake up and they immediately feel, oh, great, I can just get up, no worries, I don't feel sloggy, but they've lost a little bit of sleep. So do you think that's a good thing or a bad thing?
I'm not going to swear because I think it's being recorded, but they are, I think that's completely, the devices that use those, that technology, just going straight to swear words, I've got to try and think normally here. Those devices, one, as I mentioned earlier, don't measure deep sleep. Mm. You can kind of assume or look indirectly based on movement, but not really. So for them to suggest that they're waking you up in a lighter phase of sleep is not accurate. And the fact that they're waking, we've got athletes that aren't sleeping enough as it is, why would you wake them up 20 minutes earlier? Mm. There has been one study looking at that sleep cycle app that was the biggest, that must have made that company so much money, and completely not validated, not related to any aspect of sleep architecture. So yeah, it basically all it's doing is waking you up earlier than you really need to.
Good to know, thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. If we can thank Shona again for her talk. Very interesting that the most questions come about sleep, so maybe that's a reflection of the lack of sleep that we've all had this this week. But just in closing, I would just like to say thank you again to our presenters, and thank you to the college for accepting the proposal for this session, and thank you all for attending.